Hello everyone, CJ here. It's time for the fifth How to Dungeon Master episode. This is supposed to be the Worldbuilding and Homebrewing episode, but since these two topics are much bigger than I expected, I have to divide it into two parts. I will be covering Worldbuilding first. There is a lot to talk about here, so let's just jump into it. Worldbuilding. Why do we create our own fantasy world? Some of us do it just to satisfy our creative lust. Some of us are aspiring fantasy writers who wants to focus group their fantasy world using their friends. Guilty. Others just want to create new wonders for their players to experience and discover. Whatever is your reason, you first need to know that building a world for a D&D campaign is not the same as creating one for a novel, because your game world is something your players participate in. Don't put something in front of them unless you are willing to let them break, deconstruct, and kill it. I am saying this both out of principle and experience. Before we proceed, let's look at the pros and cons of using a published setting and creating your own world. A great published setting is populated by societies and creatures that are informed by the geography, economy, politics, religion, and the magic of the world. When you buy a source book, the work is already done for you. You only need to shell out your hard-earned cash to buy the right source book for the setting and region that you like, which can get expensive if you keep buying them. Some of your players may also have experience with the setting, so it's easier for them to wrap their heads around a setting they are already familiar with. Conversely, your original world can instill a sense of wonder into your players as they explore its unique geography and encounter its new creatures. It can be tailor-made to suit your players' tastes, and you can get away with recycling creature stats more easily. When we say world building, it doesn't necessarily mean creating a whole new world. Your world can be just a continent, a kingdom, or a city where all the events that affect your players happen. It can even be located within an existing setting such as Forgotten Realms or Dark Sun, so you are just adding little things on top of established facts of the setting. George R.R. Martin once said that there are two types of writers, the architect and the gardener. The architect plans everything ahead of time by drawing up the wires and plumbing system before building a house. The gardener dig a hole, drop in a seed, and water it. They kind of know what seed it is, but will only know how many branches it's going to have when the plant comes up. He considered himself to be a gardener. Similarly, in campaign world building, I think there are two distinct styles, top-down and bottom-up. In the top-down style, you start by asking grand-scale questions, such as, is the world a planet? How abundant is magic in it? What sort of creature or races populate the world? And to quote the great Terry Pratchett, how does shit get out and the clean water get in? There are many resources that talk about the top-down world-building process. Matthew Colville does this on his channel. You are basically applying practical knowledge in geography, economy, and sociology to derive the generalized features of your world. Once you have worked everything out, you throw your players in it to experience the natural ramification of such a world. If magic is abundant, most likely magic schools are a mundane facility the party can find everywhere. The bottom-up style starts with the NPCs and events you want your players to experience. Then, work out the history and facts of the world that produced them. Finally, you tie them all up to produce a coherent narrative. Of course, you don't have to use either approach exclusively. I tend to use both, but I rely more on the bottom-up method and let the facts I established have lasting repercussion. The point of having a well-built world is that the NPCs' behaviors and events that takes place in the world make sense, so your players can follow the pattern and formulate logical solutions for it. But be careful of what fantasy writers call the world builder's disease. Those who contracted it are so engrossed in building the world, they forget to write the story. Similarly, with setting creation, don't forget to create the adventure. What's the point of a beautifully crafted world if all your players can do in it is just sightseeing?
It's time to stop!
Too much world building can also lead to info dump sessions. It is not great to have this sort of thing happen because D&D is a game, and listening to backstory isn't. That's why many great writers use the iceberg style of world building. The readers can only see the tip of the iceberg, but they know that there is something bigger connected to it. This way, the world you create doesn't get too disruptive, and your players can concentrate on the adventure. This style can also reduce the amount of work you need to do. You just need to create whatever the player get to see and interact with. If they ask what's under that part of the water, tell them that they will find out soon enough. Then you create it before the next session. This is pretty much the bottoms-up method. Now, let me walk you through my process. I usually don't start wanting to create a new part of the world. I start by thinking about the experience I want to create for my players and a general team. What I'm about to show you is my thought process for an adventure I recently run. I started with the idea of having a legendary hero trapped in ice that the players needed to rescue. The lazy way of doing this is to just put a bunch of Arctic monsters between him and the players and call it a day. But the party I am DMing has a bar, and many of my players like social interaction. So I figured that there should be a way for them to resolve the adventure through diplomacy. To make that possible, the obstacle to the goal needs to be smart enough to talk. So I made the obstacle a Yuki Onna, a female yokai out of Japanese legend, just because I like the lore. So this decision resulted in the adventure taking place in an island inspired by Japanese culture. So it means that there is a Japan-esque civilization in my game world, and that opens up the possibility of other Earth-like culture. Then I have to come up with her goal and motive for keeping him in ice. How about if the Yuki Onna is in love with the hero and want to keep him in there as long as possible? Now, I have to think of a few solutions for my players. They can come up with their own, of course, but I have to lay down a few breadcrumbs for them to follow in case they haven't got anything. Solution 1. Diplomacy. Make her feel sorry for imprisoning him in ice. Solution 2. Fight her and win. Not bad. We are getting close to having an adventure, but it still feels too simple to me. They can just see her as a crazy woman who is caught in her deluded one-sided infatuation. Knowing my players, it's usually enough justification to kill her. I don't want the conversation to end too quickly with my players pouncing on the obvious solution for them. So I gave her the Lich's stat block, and she can fly. That would make her dangerous enough for level 14 characters, making the diplomacy option sounds pretty good right now. It's a deadly combat challenge, but still winnable. Pure combat is usually not that fun. I like to add something in the environment that rewards my players for being observant. So I added a magic sword that they can use to deal massive damage to her. It wouldn't make sense to just have it lying around, so I guess the hero brought it with him. Done. Doing combat is relatively easy, so I'm going back to workshop the diplomacy option. How can they talk her down? I guess they can make her feel remorse for what she has done. To be honest, personally, I don't think that trapping a single guy in ice is that big of a deal. He is just inconvenienced until he is free, so he needs to have a stake in it. Let's say that he has a fiancé waiting for him back home. Right now, the Yuki Onna appears to be just a simple misguided fool, and he is just an innocent victim. That sounded too simple for my liking. So let's throw some curveball to the players and add some moral dilemma. Let's make him culpable. Make it a love triangle. Also, she has blood in her hands because she needs human sacrifice to maintain her power. Then I connected all the story threads and start to weave a coherent backstory out of them. This is what I get. Once upon a time, there was a great hero who went on a quest to acquire the ice lotus of Mount Yakumo. It was the only cure for a fatal illness that he and his betrothed had contracted. He had half a year to accomplish this before they succumbed to gruesome death. With his trusty companion by his side, he went to the icy peak of Yakumo to confront the dreaded Yuki Onna, the bloodthirsty guardian yokai of the Ice Lotus. With his sword of blazing sun in hand, he was able to dispatch the foul mistress of Winter Mansion easily. But victory quickly turned to crisis as the mansion began to crumble. They were about to be buried alive until his quick-thinking companion reacted out of passion. She took up the curse of the Yuki Onna upon herself and commanded all things ice to do them no harm. She did not do this out of mere loyalty to her companion. It was love, an emotion they mutually shared, but not something he could act upon, for his love of his betrothed is greater still. This the companion knew. After finding their prize in the bottom of the mansion, they learned of two dreadful information. The Ice Lotus can only save one from the deadly illness, and its guardian would perish if it was moved out of the mansion. the agony of the choice broke the hero. The new Yuki Onna sheds tears because she understood him well enough to know that his likely decision will only lead to his doom. He was too foolish to consider himself as part of the equation. Knowing that she could not be together with him otherwise, the resourceful companion made a pact with him. Stay with her for a season, and she would let him return home with the Ice Lotus to save his betrothed. With heavy heart, he agreed, but his trust was betrayed by deception. As he slept, she encased him in magical ice, only to awaken him for a day once a year, so she can have him in her possession for longer. He was none the wiser, and lives carefree days in the mansion as years pass. To preserve the Ice Lotus, she needs to drain the blood of an innocent once every 700 days. 40 years have passed until a group of adventurers set out to find the missing hero.
It's time to stop! It's time to stop, okay?
Thanks for that, Frank. I am quite satisfied with the backstory I created. I could go on adding details forever, but I realized that it's too long. It's going to be an info dump if I needed my players to understand all the context to start empathizing with her. I can use villagers or elders to transmit some of this info, but it doesn't make sense for them to know all the story. So I had to come up with something more immediate for them to connect with. Having her appear before the players to create rapport sounds out of character. So I had to invent a proxy. A daughter, an innocent little girl that befriends the player. She needs to be likable, so I made her cute. Not only cute, but creepy cute, which makes it better. She was conceived between his waking days, so her father doesn't even know she exists. Her presence also changes the dynamic a bit. It makes killing the Yuki Onna harder because it would orphan the little girl. At the same time, it also provided them with an easy but monstrous trump card if they are pushed into desperation. My players agonized over it, but they held the little girl hostage because they were having trouble fighting her mom. And boy, do they feel bad doing it. And that, my friends, warmed my dark DM cockles. I don't usually set out to make my players feel bad, but when I do, it will be for the sweet, sweet drama juice. And that's how I do bottom-up world building. I start by focusing on my players and ask the question, what do I need to do to make my players' interaction with the world more meaningful? I project their preferred activities and I build the world and story around it. It is almost like I am making it up as I go along, isn't it? Somewhat, yeah, but as long as there is lasting repercussion and my players can use the established fact to inform their future action, it serves all the purpose of world building. Alright, that's it for the video. For the next video in the series, I will be covering the second part of the module, homebrewing. If you like this video, feel free to thumb it up. If you haven't subscribed, please do so and join the notification squad. It is a warm thank you to my patrons at Patreon for making this series possible. If you'd like to support the channel and series, please visit my Patreon page. CJ, over and out.